The Wally Show podcast is our daily radio show heard live through the WayFM app each morning and hosted by Wally, Gavin, and me, Betty Rock. For more fun, be sure to connect with us at wayfm.com/Wally.
The Wally Show podcast is brought to you by Colorado Christian University Online, where you can earn a degree online just like Betty Rock. You can learn more at ccu.edu/Wally. If you want something that feels different from the regular news, we've got you covered. It's News-ish on The Wally Show.
Back in the day, going to church meant wearing your Sunday best. But fashion has changed, and along with it, what's acceptable to wear to church? You know, you've noticed with the younger generation, like millennials and Gen Zers, they wear a lot of clothes that aren't, business-y,
or dressy, say. Yeah.
Like, we prioritize comfort and self-expression more in those generations, and it's led to something called casual activism.
Oh, whoa.
Okay,
that casual
seems...
activism.
I like this.
Very millennial.
Casual activism is kind of like saying no to the man. You know, like, the man has said you need to wear business suits and dresses and stuff, but instead being like, no, comfort is more valuable to me, and so I'm making sweatpants look good.
Oh, I care about your comfort, yes.
Yes. Well, people on Reddit are asking, what is okay now to wear to church, and listing certain clothing articles and items, and they're all being met with different opinions. So I'm gonna list for you those items, and I want to see what your opinions are on them.
Oh, okay, great. I love this.
One of the first ones was Crocs. Do you think it's okay to wear Crocs to church?
I don't think it's okay to wear Crocs anywhere. Like, I think Crocs are hideous shoes. I do get that they're a fashion thing. So, yeah, and especially if you got a Jesus gibbet on there, absolutely.
Yeah, I think kids can wear them. But if I saw, like, my worship pastor wearing Crocs on stage, I might...
I would go to another church.
Take a break.
Yeah, I'd find another church for sure.
What about jeans? Ripped or non-ripped?
Yeah. Absolutely. I wear jeans every week.
Well, you're saying yes because you wear them.
Right.
But is it okay to wear them?
Yeah.
Yeah, because I think, like, I'll wear jeans to something that says kind of like business casual or, you know, not formal, but I'll still wear jeans to most events, you know, with like a nice shirt or a jacket or something.
And like with minimal tearage. I think they need to be minimal ripped.
For a while, like, girls' jeans had a thing where it was the knee that was ripped out, and then it was the thigh that was ripped out, and then it was the thigh to the ankle, just like the whole front of the jean is
just
gone.
Just ridiculous.
Yeah, it got ridiculous.
What about leggings or yoga pants?
Well,
that's a debate people have.
That's not our opinion. I feel like what's your opinion
okay,
on that?
Well,
yeah, we're not allowed to have an opinion on that.
Oh, okay. Yeah. Well, as a girl, I would say leggings or yoga pants are okay to wear to church as long as you wear something that is long enough to cover your bottom.
And you do that all the time. Like, you wear leggings to work, but you wear long, like, shirts over them.
Yes, because I do not think it's I don't think it's appropriate to come in wearing yoga pants and then not wearing something that can cover up your bottom. It just looks a bit... It's a bit too tight. It's a bit too revealing. It doesn't do anyone any favors.
Why do you own them anyway, then?
Why do I own them?
Yeah, why should you own them anyway, then?
Because they're comfortable, and I'm all about casual activism. Yeah.
No, like, I think that they're... I think it doesn't truly matter what you're wearing to church if you're in church for the right reasons, you know? Like, I mean, it's good that you're there, you know? But I think that... After when you're there, at some point in time, you realize that there should be a respect for where you are, you know, and bringing yourself before God. I think that there's a respect that you should carry into
and
that.
Should we present ourselves before God in jeans?
I think, yeah, but again, that's where the line gets murky. Some churches would tell you no, and others, it's like, my pastor wears jeans, you know, it's not a big deal. But I think if my pastor wore yoga pants, I would be like, Jeff, we need to talk. Hey, it's the Wally Show. Who's this?
Hey, this is Janine.
What's up, Janine?
So y'all were just talking about how to dress in church.
Yeah, and there was a Reddit article on it, and everybody has a different, you know, viewpoint on what is and is not acceptable to wear in the house of the Lord.
So this is the reason I don't have a church that I go to is somewhat on this. If you have somebody coming to church, what they're wearing shouldn't matter. The fact is they're there, and some of those people have taken a step, even step in the church. and to turn around, it's like the, and I'm sorry, I'm about to cry, but it's almost like the casting crown song. You know, you put the scarlet letter on somebody before you even know them. And sometimes you take how they're dressed and you make a judgment. And we should just be thankful they're in the church and that they're wanting to hear the word and that they're wanting to know God. So, I'm sorry. It just touched a nerve.
No, I get that. So, did you ever have an experience like that?
Yes. I grew up with a single mom who could barely afford to clothe us or even give us food. And the church just looked down on us because we weren't dressed appropriately.
Do you ever see yourself stepping back into church?
Oh, I am 48 years old, And it's been a long time. So, I don't know. There's always hope, right?
You know, the thing is, and here's what I would encourage you to do, is not to let that one bad experience, you know, keep you from church. I do believe church is important for people, and you find community with fellow believers, and it can grow your faith, and it can be good in times of distress and trouble and stuff, too. And, I mean, I've never had your experience. Well, I say that. When I was a kid, I did have that experience. But, like, my church now, it's great. You know, that's never a thought for anybody there, you know, and you would fit in wonderfully and perfectly and no one would say anything to you. And so I would encourage you to maybe give it another shot and find that church that you like and can bring life and breathe life into you as well.
Well, in the meantime, I have y'all, right?
Yeah, but I'm dressed horribly on the inside, you know, like...
It's okay. I'm right there with you, Wally.
Yeah, you need a good so pastor much. In your life.
Hey, come on, I got to start somewhere. I got three of y'all. Between the three of y'all, it's balanced out, right?
There you go. Well, we appreciate you listening, Jenny. Thank you for being on the show with us. So what's your opinion about this?
Well, I just heard Jen talk about her church, had the church look down on them. And I just wanted to share that I have a pastor who gave a service once, maybe a couple of times, and told the congregation that we better not ever dare look down on anybody for the way that they dress coming in. Someone may be coming in, takes enough just to be there. And I just wanted to tell Jenny that not all churches are like that. And
yeah.
I'm so proud of my pastor.
Yeah, that's the thing. I think what we try to do so many times is we try to get everybody's, you know, behavior right or the look right. Everything like that is right. And then you come to church. And Jesus was the opposite. Jesus said, come to me with all your mess. Doesn't matter. We'll work on that other stuff later, you know, because we should change as we become believers. There are things in our lives that should change to reflect the change that God has made in us. And maybe one of those things is not dressing scantily clad to go to church, you know.
Mm-hmm.
And so maybe that's a thing for down the road. But if somebody comes and they don't feel welcome, they might not ever make it to that point down the road where God changes things in them and they make these decisions on their own, you know, based on their own faith. Well, Mary, I appreciate you weighing in on this today, and I appreciate everybody that weighs in and calls the show whenever we're talking about anything silly or serious. So thank you.
Yes, sir. Thank you.
Uplifting Way FM. This is the Wally Show. And do you like going to the grocery store, Lady Rock?
No.
No, not a fan.
Mainly just because I don't know what to buy. I don't know what to make. I just need someone to tell me what to do.
I like going to the grocery store until it gets to, like, people interactions. Because people just seem to be, like, I think oblivious, or they're in their own world, or maybe they don't like to shop, and so they're just not thinking clearly and thinking of other people. And so I have this list of a few things. I'm just curious. We're going to do something new called 3-2-1.
The game begins in 3-2-1.
I'm going to give you three scenarios that happen at a grocery store, and you just need to rank them in order from the one that bugs you the least to the one that bugs you the most. 3-2-1, okay? And so here are the scenarios. The customer who makes the rest of the line wait while they go to get something they forgot.
Oh, come on.
They're checking out and like, oh, no, I forgot the paprika. It's
nope.
Literally two things over.
Too
do you
bad.
Mind if I?
Nope, wow. I do. I mind.
Oh, you're cold. The person who's hogging the aisle and won't let you pass. Like, they've
come
got their
on.
Cart there, and then they're there. And then they kind of do this weird wave back and forth. Like, they walk a little forward and a little back,
you
and they just
no
block it.
No concept of people around them.
Yep. Mm-hmm. Or the customer who ignores the number machine at the deli, like, take a number, and they just walk up. They see everyone waiting there, and they just walk up to the front, and they're like, I'd like a pound of ham, please. Like,
What just happened?
Back of the line, Jess.
Yeah, we're in chaos world, okay? So, Gavin, 3, 2, 1 of those things, put them in order.
Okay, I have to go with 3 being the customer who makes the rest of the line wait while they go and get something.
Okay, because you've probably done that.
Done that before.
Oh, boy. Betty Rockwood.
It'd be hypocritical of me to
put
me in the most annoying. Then I'm going to go with the number machine person because I mean, I don't do the deli too often.
Yeah.
But I'm non-confrontational, so they can just get their ham.
Okay.
And then I am super annoyed by the person hogging the aisle.
Sure.
Because if I can't get past you, that means I have to walk a mile back to the main section.
And I'm not about walking in the grocery store.
<I'm not. laughs> Don't make my trip inefficient.
All right, 3, 2, 1, Lady Rock.
Boy, I'm going to go with putting last. I'm going to put the customer who ignores the takeout number just because I don't typically go to the deli.
Yeah. Oh,
but if
okay.
I did, yeah. that would be an issue for me. Coming in second, I would put the person that holds up the line to grab something.
Interesting. Oh. So you and Gavin are different in this.
Yeah. But coming in first, the most annoying is the hogging the line person.
Interesting.
Because I have been there and I have said, excuse me.
Excuse me.
Excuse me.
Yeah.
And they're still hard of hearing or something.
You don't even need much space for you to get by. You're little. And so that's a bad aisle.
But I have taken it upon myself. Yeah. When they park their buggy in the middle of the aisle, move it myself.
Atta girl. Look at you.
You need to be aware of other people.
You don't own this aisle, sir. I do.
It's getting heated up now.
All right, 3, 2, 1 for me is the customer who forgets something in the line. I've had to wait for my wife before to go get something. So I'm I don't like it, but I'm not the most annoyed because I'm guilty. 2 is the person hogging the aisle, but it's a close one with the person who ignores the takeout number.
Really?
Yeah. That happened to me at a Costco during glasses. And it's just chaos over there getting your spectacles.
Mm-hmm.
And there are people that don't realize there's a takeout number.
Mm.
And they just come up and start asking the lady, I've been here for 20 minutes waiting, you know? And you're like,
the audacity.
I know, the rules don't apply to you, ma'am. I'm so sorry. Yeah, so.
We've obviously been hurt.
Yes. Yeah, in the past.
Grocery store.
For sure. Well, there you go. That's our 3, 2, 1 for today.
It's easy to let the fear of the unknown keep us from doing something that is good for us. But going back to school might not be quite what you think.
Yeah, one of my biggest fears going back to school was I'd have to watch a ton of online lectures, and I kind of have a problem staying awake during stuff like that. But it was so different than I had imagined, and way better.
Yeah, for sure. I thought I was going to have to take a bunch of tests, which I am not a fan of. But instead, I was able to write papers, which for me was way better.
Plus, you have the flexibility to work in school around your work and life schedule. Another big fear I had is, what if I don't understand something? What do I do?
Yeah, CCU, they foster community with your classmates, and they are a great resource. And Colorado Christian University has very responsive online professors who are there to help you so you are never alone as an online student at CCU.
Learn more about how you can pursue your passion and find your calling with Colorado Christian University at ccu.edu. Colorado Christian University is a nonprofit impact partner committed to cultivating the mind without compromising the heart.
In a broken world, stories with humor, heart, or hope are a nice change of pace.
There are some things money can't buy.
It's News-ish on The Wally Show.
Not all angels have wings, and a lady named Cindy can attest to that. She was in the airport in Atlanta, and the trains were down. Atlanta is one of the busiest airports in the country, and the terminals are so far from each other. And if the trains are down, you can walk over a mile to get the terminal.
That's awful.
Yeah, it is really, really bad. But their trains are really good, but they were down. And so here's this lady who was in bad shape. She has a torn ACL.
Oh,
she needs knee replacement, and she's having to walk to try to get to her gate. So she's hobbling along, and she's got heavy bags. And this guy, Michael, saw her kind of fighting her bags and walking, and he asked if she needed help. Cindy did what we all would do. Oh, no, I'm good. I got it.
Yeah.
No, we're good. Thank you. And Michael would not take no for an answer. So he ended up grabbing her heavy bag, and he started walking with her, which at first freaked her out because she's like, what if he steals this? I can't chase him down.
Yeah.
I got a busted up knee. What am I going to do? But he didn't, and they just kind of walked and talked. And when they got to the gate, he even went up to the gate agent, and he's like, "Hey, this lady, it's my mom." He goes, "It's my mom, and she needs extra time getting on the plane today because she's got a bad knee. Could you help her out?" And the gate staff was so accommodating and helped her. Aww. So they obviously weren't flying Spirit.
they would have charged her.
Yeah, exactly. So Cindy gives him a big hug and tells him that his mom would be proud of him. So, like, aww, cool, great story.
So sweet.
Ends there. Well, when she got home, she told her son Michael about it. And they decided,
Her real son.
Yeah, they decided to try and find out who this kind stranger was. So they take to Facebook, and somehow, after posting stories and names, the way that the web works, they find the guy.
That's
like,
amazing.
Yeah, like his wife is like, "Wait, this is you," you know, kind of thing. Really strange. And so now... all of a sudden, news agencies pick up on it, and they're interviewing this guy, Michael. They're interviewing Cindy, and they're on TV, you know? Aww. And it's crazy. And, you know, it's kind of like you think that, oh, this would be a news story thing because now I'm going to reveal the big twist is that this guy was a celebrity in disguise, or, you know, they did a GoFundMe and raised $200,000. But that's not it at all. Like, the point of the story is that it's just a normal guy who did the right thing, you know? Mm-hmm. And him himself was like, I'm flattered, but I didn't do anything. And he's like, I don't get why people are making a big deal out of this. It's sad that our society's eroded to the point where I'm on TV about this.
Ooh,
and he's absolutely right.
Drop the mic.
Yeah, he's absolutely right. You know, like all that stuff, like kindness used to happen all the time back in the day, and it still happens today.
Mm-hmm.
But it's not what leads the news. It's not the narrative in the world. And I think it's sad that, yeah, this stands out because there's so much negativity that's what we consume on socials and you know, on the news and things like that. So I love that we get to tell ordinary stories like this that seem a little extraordinary. Uplifting Way FM, it's Wally's show. Who's this?
Hi, this is Shelly Martin.
What's up, Shelly?
Hi. I was just calling your conversation about people doing good things. My sister had passed away very unexpectedly last January, and my husband is a disabled vet with a service dog. And you could tell, I mean, we'd gone to a restaurant and we were just very, very down, of course.
Sure.
And when it came time, someone had paid for our meal. It's just the little things that, you know, at that time, it was a very, very low point.
Yeah.
Nobody had any idea. And you never know where someone is and how much your little act of kindness can make someone feel.
And it doesn't take much money or time to actually have an impact in somebody's day.
No, it doesn't. A simple smile can do it sometimes for me.
Absolutely. That's way cheaper, too. I'm just going to go around and smile at people all day today.
Right. We have to trust that God's going to help us know who needs help when they need help.
And I do believe that that kind of starts with waking up in the morning and going, all right, God, what are we going to do today? And starting from that mindset of being alert and aware to the opportunities that God puts in front of you to be kind and to make a difference in somebody's life. Well, Shelly, I appreciate you being on the show with us today. Thank you.
Thank you. God bless.
Uplifting Way FM. This is the Wally Show. It's a really important day for some people. It's Leap Day, which means it's the 29th of February, which you only get this every 4 years. I did a deep dive into what leap year and leap day and all that is and why it happens. Mm-hmm. But like kids that are born on leap day, you know, everyone makes jokes. Happy fifth birthday or whatever, you know.
Yeah.
And so, like, I get it. It can be frustrating for them. But this is a day where they get celebrated. There are leap day cruises for people, you know.
I had no idea. Like, but I get it because, I mean, as a kid, you're cheated out of so many birthdays.
Exactly.
Like, you deserve a cruise.
Exactly.
For sure.
And so this is what we want to do. Talking about leap day, a little turn of phrase here. What was that time that you had to take a leap of faith? Now, it doesn't have to be a faith story, but you took a leap of faith. Maybe you stepped out and you started a new business as a mom and you were like, I'm so nervous. I haven't done anything like this before. I got a cricket machine and I'm going to start labeling things and it took off for you or whatever.
Yeah, you had that dream or that aspiration and you had putting it off for years and years and years and then finally you were like, nope, yep, not anymore. I'm making a leap. I'm going to try my hand at it.
Betty Rock did this. She
did
took
I?
A leap of faith. You don't even know?
Oh, doing what?
Did what? She do?
What did I do?
What did she do?
I want to congratulate myself.
Yeah. I know.
What did I do?
She went back to school. Went to Colorado Christian University.
That's right, I did.
And got 2 degrees.
That's right,
I did. Oh, yeah. She hasn't done anything since then. Been pretty much all downhill after that.
We actually still have the congratulations balloons up in the office.
She has kept her congratulations balloons
for how many
years now?
Four
years,
yep.
Unbelievable.
Mm-hmm. Yep. So, I'm still happy for myself.
Oh, so good.
What was your leap of faith? All right. 855-33-WAY-FM. That's 855-33-WAY-FM. Who knows? You might be an inspiration to somebody who is kind of stuck there as well and on the precipice of making a big decision, and you give them the push that they need, so to speak. So 855-33-WAY-FM. Your leap of faith. We'll take it now. What's yours, Krista?
I started a house call dog grooming business. After about 10 to 15 years of doing my own family dogs, I got my grooming certification, and I launched my house call grooming business last year, and it is finally steady, and I finally have a steady income, and I'm able to also homeschool my two children thanks to my flexible schedule.
Do you have a creative name for it, like Beauty Bark or something like that?
Grooming on Demand by Krista Parasuke. So that's kind of the name that I came up with because I'm kind of on demand. You know, I come to your house and I groom your dog in your home. You don't have to worry about the exposure to other dogs.
Love that.
You don't have to worry about bringing them in the car, stressing them out.
What would you say to somebody, Krista, that's on that edge of, you know, taking that leap of faith?
I will say I tried a bunch of different things before I finally arrived at what I think I was actually meant for. And it took me a while to get there, but I didn't give up on myself. Just follow your passion. Trust yourself to just have the confidence to get out there and do it, even though you might be new at it.
And if it's dog grooming or being a doctor, get the right certifications. I think that's important, too. So nicely done. Krista, we appreciate you being on with us. Thank you.
Thank you so much. Have an awesome day, guys.
So what was your leap of faith?
I reached out to my dad after a long time, years of not talking or having any kind of relationship. We had a really bad fallout. I was probably 17 or 18, and we didn't talk until I reached out when I was about 27 or 28, and it turned out great. I don't know where my kids would be without him. He's the best grandfather I could ask for, and we just have a really close relationship, and I'm just really glad that I reached out.
What kept you guys apart for so long? Was it other people saying things about him, or you just had no relationship with him, didn't know where he was?
My parents had a really rough marriage all throughout my childhood, and it was pretty toxic, so there was a lot of other people saying things and influencing that, and I didn't feel like I could have a relationship with my mom if I had a relationship with my dad.
Oh, it's hard.
So my relationship with my mom kind of turned toxic, and then I just didn't have a relationship with either parent, and so then I reached out to him, and now here we are.
I respect the parents that, in a situation like that, don't bash each other, and they kind of let it come to themselves. Like, your dad could have been there lobbying, well, you see now your mom's the problem, you know, but when they don't do that and they kind of let it come to them, I know that's got to be the hardest thing as a parent, but I kind of respect that.
For sure, and I think that's part of why we are so close is because, and not to bash my mom, but she did that. So my relationship, and then, but he didn't. He kind of just sat there and waited, and now I think that's why I have a greater respect for him.
I love it. Well, hey, I appreciate that. You might inspire somebody to reach out and make that call today and take that step towards fixing a relationship that's kind of been dormant for a while. So I appreciate you sharing your story today. Thank you.
Yes, thanks, guys, for what you do.
So we got our friend Andy Irwin on the show with us, and he's the guy behind the movie I Can Only Imagine, and now he has a new movie out called Ordinary Angels starring Hilary Swank, and she is great, by the way. And her passion for this film really comes through in her character, who's like this broken mess, but God still uses her to accomplish a miracle in the life of a desperate single father whose daughter is in need of a liver transplant. True story, by the way. Now, the one thing I love about you, Andy, is that your movies are not preachy. I would put this somewhere like... you got Blindside at one end, yeah, and you've got War Room at the other. You guys are ahead of Blindside on the faith, but way under War Room, you know? But it's done in a way that's like accessible and not off-putting, and it's not heavy-handed.
I think it preaches as good as any of the films that we've done.
Because I know your heart is not to water down the gospel.
No. Our heart is to be strategic. This one was really about trying to understand this everyman kind of blue-collar guy that had a relationship with God but was just burnt out.
Yep.
And he felt like he'd lost faith in the church and lost faith in God really seeing him and being there for him. So it's kind of that skeptic that's outside the church walls that we want to reach.
Well, you do a great job of that, and it reached into my chest and punched me in the heart in the first 3 minutes. It's a great movie, and it will be in theaters February 23rd, and you can actually get tickets now at ordinaryangels.movie.
More than just a beautiful face, here's Gavin.
We're having a moment here. Don't ruin it.
I bet you thought I was going to say Betty. It's news-ish on The Wally Show.
In about 5 months, my wife and I will be welcoming our first child into the world. And in our
only 5 months?
Oh, yeah.
That's not that far.
You're telling me, man.
Yeah, oh my gosh, I'd be panicking.
Thanks for the encouragement.
Yeah, just playing on all of his anxieties.
But in our case, we live very far away from both of our parents. My parents are a 22-hour drive, a flight away. Her parents are a day's drive away, so we are really like raising this kid in a town where it's just us. And we do. We have a great church. We've got great friends. So we're not too worried on that front. But both of us are going to be working parents in this scenario because we live in a relatively expensive city.
Right.
And we both just need to keep working. So we're going to be working parents. And I found this article that says when it comes to the average working parent, when it comes to raising their child, they rely on 6 different people to support their child's growth and development.
Oh, that's interesting. Please don't let coworker be on there.
Well, you know who not to call.
Well, no, Betty, for
me?
Sure.
I thought you were talking about yourself.
No. Well, Gavin's geez. Like, hey, we're doing a baby shower, and you feel free to say no, but you guys, I'd like to invite you. And I'm like, absolutely. And Betty's like, am I a bad person if I say no?
But it is funny because, you know, when it comes to child care, you're the one who used to work in child care.
And I love kids.
Yeah.
And I have, I've asked you questions. Like, you might be the person I ask questions of, but I feel like I can promise I won't ask you to babysit my kid.
Okay. Well, I mean, if you're in a bind, let me know.
Okay. Really? Okay.
Yeah.
Well,
yeah.
Coworker, number one on this list.
Was it really? No. I'm like, no way.
No. So this one, actually, they did a breakdown. Of the people, and they do list family members such as like grandparents and extended family members, aunts and uncles being a big one. Siblings was up there. Mm-hmm. And again, all of this is for people who live.
Right, because all your people are away, so they're not near you.
No. And so then after that, this is kind of where you sort of, I think, get into where we'll be in our situation when it comes to the village of people that raise the kid. It includes, on this list, it included the best friend, neighbors. And then they also listed out like teachers and instructors or childcare like people. Sure. And it was interesting. I saw this number. It said on average, children spend 4 days a week with their support system and not the parents per se.
Interesting.
And so I hear that and I think about that. I'm like, oh, that's going to be like a lot of time that I'm having my kid be with all of these other people. And you do. You want that village and that system to be trusted, especially for us as working people without family in town.
We had friends that we went through it at the same time with, like our next door neighbors, and they were like family to us, you know? And so it was good because we at least had that. Like we each kind of helped spell the other one, and they grew up together. And so it made it a little bit easier. And so you have friends that have kids, right?
We've got a few friends that do have kids in town. So
that helps.
It's going to be nice to have that camaraderie. And then it's also nice, again, we have a church, and that church has a place that we're able to, kind of like a daycare type thing that we're going to be able to take advantage of. And for me, we love our church, and so that's going to be, in my head, an easy place to trust our kid going to.
Sure.
I'm curious about that, like the first day you drop off your kid. I've heard that can be
tough
stressful. For some parents.
Yeah, not for me.
You're like, so long, sucker!
Deuces! I'll see you in 8! uplifting Way FM. This is The Wally Show. We're going to do a little small group therapy, and this is where I'll share with you, or Betty or Gavin will share with you at times, something from their small group that, you know, we went to and kind of picked out something like, oh, that kind of makes a little bit of sense. Like, we were talking about anxiety and, you know, what that looks like in people's life, and it's different for everybody. Like, I tend to look at my stuff more as I'm anxious in the moment, but I don't suffer from anxiety. Because I think anxiety is different from being anxious, and anxiety is, like, serious and crippling, and it's more persistent, whereas anxiousness ebbs and flows, and it doesn't wreck you. That's my own personal take on it, and you can disagree with me or agree with me if you want. But we were talking about this and how to manage it, and the analogies that they came up with, it's actually Max Licato, and I love the couple analogies he gave, and maybe one of these will land with you. It says, when you have an appliance that breaks, you may try unsuccessfully to fix it, and then you have to take it to a repairman who knows better than you what's going on and how to fix it. And so, do you stay and offer to help the repairman? I do.
Of course you do.
Yeah, I'm like, I'm annoying to have any contractors for. I'm like, hey, let me help. Or, you know, do you hand him tools? No, you simply tell him what the problem is, and you let him work on it, and then he's going to call you when it's ready to be picked up again. And he was making the analogy that anxiety is like that. You might be not prepared to handle it, but Jesus is, and you can turn that over to him, let him take it. You can cast your cares upon him, like it says in the Bible, and then you can feel free to let it go. And then when the time is right, you can pick it back up again, you know?
I like analogies because it does help picture it, what the lesson is, a little bit easier. I guess it's kind of like what Jesus was doing back in the day with his
parables.
Parables, yeah. But to me, it does kind of put the things in a different perspective. And it also helps me remember those lessons, too.
Absolutely. And so that's what we want to talk about. What was that kind of spiritual analogy that helped you understand something, or that you just don't forget because it was so good? You're like, man, I wish I had said that. Like, that's really, really poignant to what I'm going through right now. And a lot of times, too, people will do these analogies, then they'll do them in just a few sentences, and you're like, man, that's so good, you know? And so I'm just curious if you've got one of those, because your analogy, the thing that helped you, could be the thing that helps somebody else out, and that's one of the things we like to do on the show. So 855-33-WAY-FM. That's 855-33-WAY-FM. We'd love to get yours right now. What's like a spiritual analogy, Stacey, that landed with you?
Well, the one that landed with me was when I was going through a really tough time. I was thinking I was going to go on a mission trip, and then it didn't happen, and then this happened, and that happened, and, you know, I was sitting crying about it, and my friend looked at me and said, you need to understand, he's either preparing you for something or sparing you from something.
That's good.
She said, either you're not ready or he's not ready for you to have it yet.
Yeah, how many times have we missed out on something, we thought we missed out on something, but we don't see the other side of that story, or the thing that we could never see, and it was God actually sparing us from some unbelievable heartache. We just know the little thing we missed out on, but it could have been something way worse.
I have to remember sometimes that God is a God of character, not a God of convenience.
That's true, because sometimes in that waiting is where he's building our character, and he's more concerned about our character than he is about our calendar.
Exactly.
So what's yours?
Yeah, so I'm friends with this lady on Facebook, and she kind of uses Facebook as a ministry platform. And she posted the other day that she's making breakfast for her kids, and one of her children asked her for a glass of milk. So she goes to turn around to go to the refrigerator to get them a glass of milk, and her son is just standing there at her feet, you know, where she can't move. It was just like, you know, we ask God for these things, and then, you know, he turns around to work in our lives, and we're standing right in his way. So it just spoke to me, because we ask for these things, and do we fully surrender it to God? Do we get out of his way, or are we blocking our own blessing?
I understand this, because I'm a kind of a control freak, and so, like, I'll surrender something to God for an hour, and then
if you're lucky.
Yeah, on a good day, and then I'm like, you know what? You haven't moved fast enough. I'll take over again, you know? And you're right,
right.
And we are, like, impatient children. But the good thing is he usually doesn't yell at us like our moms do.
Absolutely.
So what's yours?
Mine is you don't get clean before you get in the bathtub. So in other words, God wants you just the way you are. And as you have a relationship with him, he's going to clean you up as you go. He doesn't want you perfect.
Yeah, a lot of times as a church, we focus on, okay, what you need to do to be a good Christian and how you need to look, how you need to talk, how you need to dress, all that stuff. And you got to get all these things right first. And then you come to church and then you do this. But you're right. God is like, man, just come on. It's more important that I spend time with you and all that stuff. We'll work on that later and it'll change later once I change you from inside.
I think that's a great analogy. I think that's something I'm actually going to start remembering because it's easy to remember. And two, I constantly find myself falling into that pit of feeling like I need to clean myself up before I come to God.
You know what, Rock, to make this even more applicable for you, I think it would be like you don't have to hose yourself off before you come to God.
Oh, that hits so close to home. Man. Amen and amen. Growing up in poverty has never been easy for children, but with the added challenges of the pandemic, conflict, and natural disasters, families around the world are facing an unprecedented food crisis. Unfortunately, those who are already hungry are now even more desperate. But by sponsoring a child through Compassion, you can help provide life-sustaining essentials such as food and clean water. And with your compassionate support, that child can not only survive, but also flourish. You can find out how and choose a child to sponsor when you click on the Compassion banner at wayfm.com.
Uplifting Way FM. This is The Rock Report with Bayrock.
Vague booking is defined as the practice of making a post on social media that is intentionally vague, but highly personal and emotional and designed to elicit concerned responses from friends and family.
It frustrates me when people do that.
It
just tell me.
It does me too, and especially too when people play into it. That frustrates me even more when they're commenting and saying, well, what's going on?
Right.
No, this is exactly what they want. Don't play into their game.
Yeah, just either say it or don't.
Yes, it's typically just seen as annoying behavior and a desperate call for attention or need for validation. And the most recent culprit of vague booking is Stephen Baldwin. He's the younger brother of actor Alec Baldwin and father-in-law to pop icon Justin Bieber.
Oh, yeah. Woo! Oh, little JB.
Well, Baldwin recently tweeted, quote, "Christians, please, when you think of Justin and Haley," so his daughter and Justin's wife, "take a moment to offer a little prayer for them to have wisdom, protection, and to draw close to God." He even went on to say, "There are special challenges that folks in high visibility face, and also the enemy doesn't want them to draw closer to Jesus."
Oh, okay. Well, I can read through those lines and go, all right, they obviously there's a spiritual battle going on.
But here's the problem.
What is the problem?
It's just vague enough to cause concern. And for their fans, Bieber fans or Haley fans, to be like, oh my gosh, please don't tell me they're on the brink of divorce.
Right.
Please don't tell me that there's a health issue. Like, and it's causing concern where maybe there shouldn't be
what
that
I
level
read
of
into
concern.
That. Yeah, what I read into that is the marriage is in trouble and
falling apart.
They're falling away from God. Like, that's what I read into that.
Wow.
And but I mean, am I wrong? Am I off base?
Well,
is that what you read into that?
A lot.
But that's not what you had. That's not how you took it.
But what if it's just like they had a little tussle
that would be bad
that morning, and then they got over it,
right?
And talked about it.
Yeah, but this one seems like it is that. And that's the problem with vague booking. More than it being annoying is when you're not really specific, then people speculate. And especially with celebrities, speculation is actually damaging. You know, it's like it's not healthy.
Because people assume the worst.
Right.
It's almost like when someone is like you're taking prayer requests and people are like, I have an unspoken that has to do with so-and-so.
Yeah.
And it has just left me.
How am I supposed to pray for that?
In a tailspin.
You know, I need the dirt. Give me the tea. If you want me to bring this before the Almighty, I'm
going to
need the
everything.
Tea.
Great Googly Moogly.
Googly Moogly.
Great Googly Moogly.
Uplifting Away FM. This is The Wally Show. Got a chance for you to win a prize. We're going to play a game called Great Googly Moogly. Gavin is our Google Meister. He will ask Google an open-ended question Betty and Rock and I will try to answer that question. And if we get the answer right, we get 1 point. Because Google autofills like its own answers to it, like the top five. If we get the number one answer, we get 2 points. Now, you'll be listening to this because you'll see who's doing better. Because when we play with you in your round, one of us might help you win not one, but two prizes if you get the number one answer. So that's the way it works. So with that said, Gavin, great Googly Moogly. What's question number one?
All right. So this is kid related. Why won't my kid stop blank?
Oh, boy. Because if Betty Rock and I both say the same thing, it negates our answers.
And that's not fair because you're a parent.
I know. But I mean, the obvious one is there, but I'm afraid you'll take that one. Why won't my kid stop?
Okay. I'm going to go with my gut.
Okay. I got mine too. Go with yours.
Okay, why won't my kids stop screaming? Mm.
Okay, see, that's what I thought you were going to go with.
Uh-huh.
And so I did not go with that.
Good for you.
I went with, why won't my kids stop calling other people daddy?
Oh. Wow.
Is that experience?
I don't know if Google is the place where you need to ask that question. Maybe look into it like a family therapist.
Yeah. Yeah. I'm just curious. Like, does she want a different father? I don't know.
My goodness. Clarify real quick. It's not on the list.
It's not. Okay. So, okay. Well, darn it.
I think it's a good thing that that's not.
Maybe.
But screaming was number five on
what?
The list.
Oh.
So how is that not number one?
I guess it's interesting because crying was number three. Which those you are, could theoretically put those in. Random one that, again, this is Google. It's weird. Pretending to be a lion was just on this list.
Okay,
I don't
that's
know why.
Weird.
And then talking and coughing was number one.
Oh coughing. Because right now RSV is a thing.
It is.
Yeah,
it is.
That's why I want kids to start coughing. Okay, there you go. That's question number one. What's number two? So Betty Rock, you did well. You got a point.
Thank you.
Okay, do my friends think that I'm blank?
Mm-hmm.
I'm looking at Betty, and I have my answer.
Uh-oh, you better not say what I said, because I'm looking right at you.
I'm looking right at you. We each answered based on the other person. Okay, we'll say our answers on three.
Okay.
Ready?
I'll be so
three,
impressed.
Two, one.
Annoying.
Needy. Oh. Okay.
One and the same.
Okay, is needy, Betty Rock needy style on the list?
It is not on the list.
What?
Is Wally annoying on the list?
Annoying was on the list.
Yes!
Nuts! Betty Rock, again, that's
was that
2 points.
Was that the number one answer?
So you had funny, unhealthy, weird. Number one was ugly.
Oh,
pretty harsh.
Sad.
Well, I get that, though. Like, you always want to have one friend that's less good-looking than you. That's like a thing. Yeah, it's a thing. I've
that?
Never had that. I've always been the less good-looking friend. But one day...
Wow.
Oh, wait, I got Gavin.
Stop no. it. Got some, at least I'm not
sorry.
Wrinkly and old.
Sorry, snap. That was on me. That hurt people. I'm sorry. Yeah. All right, we're going to play with you
ouch.
Now. 855-33-WAY-FM. That's 855-33-WAY-FM. You're going to get a great Googly Moogly question, and maybe Betty Rock will be the thing that helps you out today because she did well in our round. 855-33-WAY-FM. If you want to play, that's 855-33-WAY-FM.
Great Googly Moogly.
Googly Moogly.
Great Googly Moogly.
Uplifting Way FM, this is The Wally Show. Laura Marie, welcome to Great Googly Moogly. And the way this works is Gavin has asked Google an open-ended question. We're all going to try to guess an answer that Google auto-filled. Now, you can go with your answer, you could go with Betty Rock's or mine. If you get an answer on the top five list, you win a prize. If you get the number one answer, you win two prizes. So with that, Gavin, what is our question?
Okay, it is... Is AI going to blank?
Is AI going to blank? Okay, I have an answer. Betty, do you have an answer?
Yes, I do.
Okay, do you have an answer, Laura Marie?
I do have an answer.
Okay, what is yours?
Is AI going to take over the world?
Ooh. Okay, that's good. That's a little bigger than mine. I said take my job.
Okay.
You know, because if you've been to McDonald's, all of a sudden they got like kiosks everywhere, and it's like, whoa, it's hard to get someone to take your order anymore.
Yeah.
Betty Rock, what did you say?
I went more on a positive note. Is AI going to self-destruct?
Oh. Okay. All right. Weird that that's your version of positive.
Well, it's true because AI could take your job. That's negative.
That's true. Yeah. Okay. So with that being said, Laura Marie, do you want to stick with your answer or do you want to take mine or Betty's? You can go any direction you want. Now, she did really well in our round, but I'm not feeling too confident about her answer on this one.
Okay, let me ask my kids. Should I keep my answer or take one of theirs? We're going to keep my answer according to my kids.
Yeah, she's like, keep your answer. You're way smarter than them.
Got it.
Okay. All right, so Gavin, did Betty Rock's Self-Destruct make it on the list?
That one did not make the list.
Okay, that's good news. That's good news. Okay, did Take My Job make the list?
It was Replace Jobs was number 2 on the list.
Uh-oh. Okay, so you would have had a guaranteed prize had you gone with me. Now, here's the deal. If you make it on the list, you win a prize. If you get the number one answer, you get 2 prizes. So with that said, Gavin, is AI going to take over the world according to Laura Marie?
She is walking away with 2 prizes.
Nice!
She crushed it.
Woo! 2 prizes, guys.
That's amazing. Your kids were definitely right. Their guts were right on this one. Ice cream for everyone.
Hey!
Laura Marie, we appreciate you guys being on the show with us today, and thanks for playing Great Googly Moogly.
Thanks so much. Y'all have a good day.
Star Search.
Uplifting at Way FM, this is The Wally Show, and Betty Rock hosts our Star Search segment because you found this thing where it's posts and different things that celebrities are making, and it kind of dives into what they actually might be saying or what they might be looking for, right?
Right. Superstars may seem like they have it all thanks to money and popularity, but ultimately they're still searching for something, and these are the lessons that we can learn from them. So we're going to talk about Demi Lovato. Before Demi Lovato made it big as a child actor on Disney Channel's Camp Rock and Sunny with a Chance.
I did love that, actually.
Those are good shows.
Her parents did their best to start her off on the right foot by taking her to church. But like it is for many before her, she saw behavior from so-called Christians that she didn't agree with, and it led her on a different path.
There was a lot of shame that came from the church and my religion that I didn't think that my God, the one that I believe in, I don't think that he or she or they would judge me for loving everyone.
Covered all the bases there.
Mm-hmm. Yeah. And I think it's
there's a problem with theology out of the gate.
Yeah, I think it's a good reminder for all of us that claim to be Christians that people, you know, kids like Demi Lovato, whether we're believers or non-believers, whether people are watching us that are believers or non-believers, they are watching.
Right.
And how we conduct ourselves can lead someone to or away from God. And since her exit from the church, Demi's path hasn't been an easy one. I don't know if you remember this, but I think it was maybe 2 years ago, she had a really bad substance abuse issue, and she actually had to be brought back with Narcan.
Yeah.
Like, it was a really bad situation. She's also recently released an album, and I can't say the title of it, but the whole thing has deliberate religious undertones all in it. And when we ask her, like, what is the purpose of the album, she said it was to release the anger that she has from her spiritual walk.
Wow. That's sad, actually.
It is. It's sad because you would think that what does she have to be angry about? Like, she has money, she has popularity, but she's obviously still searching for what truth is. And so I think it's just a good lesson for all of us that the church is built up of sinners. I think that's a very important thing to remember, that none of us are perfect and only God belongs on that perfect pedestal. And so, yes, you're going to come across people that might give you a wrong message at church, but that's where you got to lean on your faith and on your relationship with God.
But the problem is when you don't know who he truly is, then you can't even do that. You heard her say, whatever, you know, she has no idea. And that's, to me, is the sad thing. Because when you say, the God I believe in, you've substituted truth of who God really is for the God you create, because it reinforces what you want to believe is true. But that doesn't do anybody favors when you're not sharing truth with them. And so truth in love has probably not been shared with her.
Well, and too, it just goes to show that even if you're seeking your truth or whatever you want to call it, it doesn't make you any happier. She's now got an album that's all about anger. Mm-hmm. And so I think it's important that we cling to our faith even harder when we're feeling those moments of wanting to pull away. I mean, who doesn't? We're all in those situations at times, but that's when we need to surround ourselves with people that are like-minded, that can enforce us to keep searching for God.
Because your faith should bring you peace, and it should bring you contentment and joy. And hopefully, she'll get to that point. You know, she's not there now. But then again, we all take our rabbit trails. So she's not there now. She's definitely not beyond the scope of God's love. And you just hope and pray that somebody will be a good representation of faith for her and get her to that place. Well, there you go. That's your star search. Thank you, Lady Rock.
Behold God stuff.
Uplifting Way FM. This is the Wally Show. And God stuff is where we like to focus on, you know, God doing his God thing outside of the walls of the church. And Hulk Hogan is talking about his faith after he and his wife recently got baptized. Like, oh, that's kind of cool. The Hulks are Hulkamania.
Oh, he didn't say this. Step into a slim jump.
No, that was, not Ric Flair. Don't get me started. Like, that was Randy Macho Man Savage. That's the extent of my wrestling knowledge, though. Like, mine's all old school.
Do you smell what The Rock is cooking?
There you go. Hulk Hogan said, I was always a believer.
Let's get ready to rumble.
Not him. That's Michael Buffer, the announcer. I've always been a believer, but I didn't completely surrender. Hogan said, I thought I could drive better than he could. I thought I could make the decisions better than he could. Boy, does this sound like all of us at one point in time? And now he takes his hands off the wheel and says, okay, you think you can do it better? Go ahead. So like I said, I got tired of crashing and burning at this point with 40-year career behind me. I understand now that it was a temporary situation to set me up for the next run. So I was like, oh, that's kind of cool. That's a good perspective, too, that everything that led him to where he's at now is somehow got out of hand in and is moving him into the next thing. He posted a clip of him and his wife getting baptized, and he said, total surrender and dedication to Jesus is the greatest day of my life. That's a pretty big statement from somebody who's probably from the outside world had a lot of great days, as you look at it. You know?
And, too, it's sad that it... I mean, I was looking to see how old he is. He's 70 years old.
No, he's not.
Yes, 70
Hulk?
Years old.
He's been around.
And so it just goes to show, like, it takes us forever to figure out that God is the answer.
Yeah.
You know, like, sadly, we can't figure it out when we're younger, but we figure it out when we're older.
He laid out the gospel very simply for people in this article, too. He said, you know, I don't have my act cleaned up, and I can't. And if you're like one of those people that says, I don't think I can do this, you have all the excuses for being in the wrong place or at the wrong time, not being enough. You don't need to be cleaned up to come to him. He'll clean you up. And like, there you go. That's really solid, and it's very true. He got saved when he was 14, but he said he wasn't living for God through that whole time. And I think that's a really common story. And I think that that's why I really, you know, think the work that people do in the church with the youth is so important. Gavin does this. Gavin volunteers and spends time pouring into the youth group at his church. And so it's like, you never know, because you can't judge anybody's salvation. You could look at what they're doing now, and they might be doing horrible things, but you don't know if they met some youth pastor years ago and got saved. Because a lot of times people do get saved when they're young, and then they take their rabbit trails. Mm-hmm. And so the work that youth people do, you know, whether they're pastors or just people like Gavin volunteering, is so vital in people's lives. And it one of those things, I'm sure, like his youth pastor, to watch him come full circle now would be pretty cool.
Yeah.
And it's a great thing. Like, if you don't, you know, if you don't think you matter or you want to have an impact, maybe this is something you think about. Man, maybe I should work with the kids, because you see from Hulk's story, it can have a life, eternal life impact in somebody even years down the road. And that's your God stuff.
Well, that's the end, but it doesn't have to be. Check out our Aftercast. It's new stuff you didn't hear in the podcast. Be sure to rate us on iTunes as well as connect with us on social media. Just search Wally Show. And if you'd like to join our Facebook group made exclusively for you potties, the link is in the description of this podcast. Thanks to Colorado Christian University Online for supporting what we do.